This is my take on a puddle jumper from Stargate Atlantis, a made for survival small grid hydrogen ship that's mostly just meant to be a fun ship to play around with some cool features, but it can actually be quite useful in certain situations in survival. I've actually been working on this off and on over the last year, and I finally landed on a design I'm happy with. The final design comes out to about 900 blocks and nearly 10,000 PCU. So I'll give you a look around the outside, and then we'll take a look at how everything works and take it for a spin. Now, starting off with the side, you mostly see just the armor shape. It's about as rounded as I could get it and still have everything work. You can see the drive pod here is mostly hidden when it's closed. Same with the rocket pod here up at the front. Back here behind the drive pods, you can see this fin here, and under this armor paneling, you can actually see one of the many small hydrogen tanks that make up the ship's outer hull. If I step back, you can actually see up on the top, single ion thruster for emergency maneuvering left and right, and ahead of that is a single small hydrogen thruster for when the drive pods are closed. And you can see with the drive pods now open, there are another three left and right maneuvering hydrogen thrusters. In addition to that, each drive pod has two reverse thrusters, two lift thrusters, and two forward thrusters. And both drive pods each use a pair of merge blocks so that they can merge in when they're open, so that it doesn't need to use any kind of scripts or event controllers for subgrid thruster control. For opening and closing the drive pods, I have opted for a double hinge setup rather than a piston setup, so that when the drive pods open, they can come out and slide backward in order to reveal some hidden lateral thrusters. In addition to the drive pods opening and closing, there are front rocket pods that open and close that contain a single fixed rocket launcher. And inside the opening is a hidden inset light to just light up the area a little bit, make it look cooler. Same with the drive pods, they have a little bit of ambient lighting inside when they're open. So moving around to the front, you can see the big front windshield. Inside you can see the two rover cockpits used to control the ship. On either side there is a front-facing spotlight, and under that is a single corner light to help light up the area. On the main grid there are two Gatlings here under the spotlights, in addition to the two Gatlings, one on each drive pod and the two rocket pods. That's a total of six fixed weapons on here. Under the chin here at the front, there are two reverse hydrogen thrusters. So two on the main grid and then two on each drive pod for a total of six reverse hydrogen. And above the cockpit is a camera facing forward through an artificial horizon LCD for remote piloting or long range targeting. Here at the front, you can see some more of the small hydrogen tanks that make up the ship's hull. So that's about it for the front. Let's take a look at the back. Here at the back, this is the main entrance into the puddle jumper. There is a folding ramp with a door behind it, a button to open and close the ramp. There are some ambient corner lights out here to light the area. Another pair of corner lights to light the area when the ramp is open. A pair of spotlights on the back to see behind the jumper. A camera to see behind the jumper. A pair of magnetic plates to lock the ramp down when it is closed. Of course, at the back here, you can see that there are four small hydrogen thrusters on the main grid, in addition to two ions for backup. Again, on each drive pod, there are two forward thrusters for a total of eight forward hydrogen thrusters. There's also a small reactor. Since it mostly runs on hydrogen fuel, there are not very many batteries, so this can be good to throw a little uranium in there just in case the batteries die. The roof of the jumper is mostly skinned with weldless armor panels, covering up more small hydrogen tanks. At the middle here, you can see an AI flight block that is currently turned off. Here toward the front, you can see a pair of parachute hatches, and toward the back, another pair of parachute hatches. On each of the back corners, you can see a single ion thruster pointing upward for emergencies. There's also a total of four small hydrogen thrusters pointing up on the main grid, and as you can see, none on the drive pods pointing upward. The bottom of the jumper, in contrast, is much busier. In the middle, there is a connector. There's also a downward-facing camera to align docking, a sensor for proximity detection, a sound block to go with the sensor. You can also see several main grid lifting hydrogen thrusters, a total of three mag plates for landing on the ground, and of course, countless small hydrogen tanks to maximize fuel time. Now, let's take a look at the interior. The interior is broken up into two pressurized compartments. This is the rear compartment. On each side, there are two benches for passengers, two weapon racks for them to stow their firearms. Each seat also has an assigned small cargo container to hold things like bottles. Above the two forward benches, there is a window to see out to the drive pods so that you can see whether they have successfully closed all the way, because they are subgrids and they don't always do what they're supposed to. On the right-hand side toward the front above the bench is a button for opening or closing the drive pods. In the floor, you can see the top of the docking connector, which is the only substantial cargo container on the ship. It is configured with an Izzy special inventory to load it with canvas, Gatling, and ice, normally. Also on the floor, you can see the same small hydrogen tanks that you can see from the bottom of the ship. On the ceiling are more hydrogen tanks, but in the middle is a sensor for activating or deactivating the interior lights when the player leaves or enters the interior. Above the door, there is a button for the rear door controls. It is on a timer so that it can lock the mag plates and then open the front door. When the rear door starts to open, it depressurizes the rear compartment using this air vent before opening the door. The forward section has the two rover cockpits that we saw before, a single passenger seat in the forward section. On the other side, where there would be another passenger seat, there is an O2H2 generator. I've opted to use that instead of an oxygen tank because it is a little smaller and is a little bit more versatile. I would prefer to have a small oxygen tank like these small hydrogen tanks, but that is currently only available with a mod. To the left of the left rover cockpit seat, you can see a single programmable block running automatic LCDs. Ahead of the two rover cockpits are a set of transparent LCDs showing artificial horizon, a toolbar guide, an indicator whether the autopilot is engaged, and targeting info. So now I'll jump in the cockpit and take a look at the controls. On the first page of the toolbar is a front-facing camera, Gatling guns, rocket launchers. Number 5 is to open or close the drive pods. Number 7 is to open or close the rocket pods. Number 8 and 9 is to turn on and off the antenna or beacon. On page 2, number 1 is to start up the jumper. Number 2 is to shut down the jumper. And those will activate or deactivate all of the essential flight blocks, toggle batteries and tanks to stockpile or recharge. Number 3 is to stop the proximity alert sound block. 4 and 5 are bottom and rear docking cameras. 6 is auto lock for the bottom mag plates. 7 is to switch lock. 8 is to turn on or off the connectors. 9 is to switch lock on the connector. On page 3 are controls for the parachute hatches. Number 1 is to turn on or off auto deploy. Number 2 is to open or close. 3 is to turn on or off the repair projector, which includes the drive pods in their open position. Number 5 is to launch the puddle jumper as an AI drone. Number 7 is to activate AI offense. And number 9 is to activate the return home sequence. So now I'll fly it around a little bit to give you an idea of what it's like to fly. With the drive pods open, it maneuvers pretty well. Pretty decent lift. Pretty decent lateral thrust. Good forward thrust. The gyro power is more than sufficient. And overall, it is pretty maneuverable for how big and heavy it is. However, with the drive pods closed and with the rocket pods closed, it does have a lot less side-to-side thrust, making it considerably slower. It also has quite a bit less lifting thrust. And it has quite a bit less reverse thrust. So, overall, if you're gonna go into combat, you wanna have the drive pods open. Now, because the puddle jumper does use subgrids, it is not a simple task to build it in survival. So, in order to make that easier, I've made a DIY version that has all of the subgrids attached, along with step-by-step instructions on how to get it fully assembled. So I'll get that loaded up into this projector. Okay, so I've got the projection loaded up here. I will go ahead and hit build. Okay, now that it's all finished, step one is to remove hinge parts from the orange hinges. That one, that one. It can be very tricky to actually pick the right thing. There we go. We're just grinding the hinge part out of the hinge. All right, that's step one. Step two is to press this button to move the hinges into position. Simple enough. And as you can see, the first stage hinge for all of the pods moves into position. Step three is to add a hinge part back onto the existing hinge parts that we just moved using the button. So, one there, one there. One there. And one there. That is all four hinge parts added. Next is step 3A, grind blue blocks to detach ramp. So that is this right here. And the idea with these red blocks is that if you have this sitting on the ground, the red blocks will support the ramp off the ground and keep the hinge aligned for the hinge part to attach. But since I do have it raised up for this connector, I need to make a platform for it to land on. So I'm going to use a conveyor converter. Couple of those to make a floor for that, then grind that off, and it is now lined up. Step four is to press this button to attach all hinges. Press that. So you can see the ramp is now attached, the rocket pod hinge is attached, that is attached, that is attached, and that has attached. Now step five is to press this button to turn on the repair projector. Step six is to replace the missing blocks on the ramp. There are four half armor blocks and one half slope block. So grind all these off, grind off the converters. Okay, that's done. Step 6A, add missing 2x1 tips on rocket pods, two per side behind the purple block. Two there, paint the purple block, paint the orange hinge, the orange part. All right, purple block, two there. Paint the purple block, paint the orange hinge, paint the orange part. Step 6B, grind all red blocks. And that would include these parts here. So step 6C is weld all blocks missing from projector. Okay. Okay, I'm going to use the piston welders to repair the remaining blocks. All right, everything is complete now. Activate the puddle jumper shutdown timer to lock the connector and fill the tanks. Going to close the ramp and split it. And there we go. One completed puddle jumper ready for action. It's not exactly simple, but it is doable. Now time for a combat test. So I'm gonna load up with supplies and head up into space, pick a fight. Okay, I'm all loaded up. Time to go to space. Thank you. Okay, gonna make a pit stop here at the trade station. Oh, after a good night's sleep, I'm ready to get back into the cockpit. Now, let's go find something to fight. Hopefully my ship didn't get towed. Okay, I've cleared the station. Let's see what we got. 3.45 kilometers, a Cert Thumberbird. I would probably die if I tried to take that on directly. So what I'll do is I will aggro it, spawn the drones, and then try fighting the drones. So I'll just get into detection range and try to stay out of range with their main turrets. Oh, that was quick. Okay, taking on the fruit fly first. Rockets did their job there. Go back after the Thumberbird. Cockpit is still pressurized. Everything looks okay for the most part. Oh, they're shooting my rockets. Try to conserve ammo so I don't burn it all on the fanged drones. Looks like I'm out of rockets. Go back in. Lost cabin pressure. Oh, salt cannons are shooting me. Taking fire. Oh, taking a lot of fire. If I catch one of those assault cannon rounds, it's over. Let's see if I can get under them. Shape. That did not go well. Those are important parts. Alright, let's see. Didn't go great, but I can still fly, technically. I have no weapons left. I'm just gonna launch myself back into orbit and land on parachutes. So, that's about it for the Stargate Puddle Jumper. I think it's pretty cool. As you can see, it's not a great combat ship, but it holds its own against some drones. If you want to take it for a spin, the link to the workshop page will be in the description, along with the link to the DIY version for building and survival. Thank you very much for watching, and goodbye.